Guys, I had a lot of trouble coming over here today. Well, the first thing was I couldn't see my music at the end of the lyre, so that's for starters, so now I got to hang it a little lower. But the other day, my bathroom got on fire and burned up. And it was bad.
You okay?
I'm okay, but I was lucky. It didn't reach the house. Ladies and gentlemen, we're going to bring you in on the scene of two duck hunters from Johnstown.
Paul, I'm tired. It's been a heck of a day, and we haven't caught a darn duck. What do you think we're doing wrong?
I don't know, Bill. You think we should throw the dog up higher?
Yeah.
Annapolis, to that Navy school at Annapolis.
Yeah, I did, Neil. How'd you know that?
I sensed it from your dapper dress, from your bearing, from your very quick wit, and from your athletic ability.
Neil, didn't you go to Penn State?
Yeah, I went to Penn State. How did you know that?
I saw the ring on your finger when you were picking your nose.
Finger. Ladies and gentlemen, it has been said that our star trumpet player, Bill Mackie, gives the finest rendition of an automobile race in history. And here's the guy that said it, Bill Mackie.
Now the starter says, okay, and now they go! It's car number 234. four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, ten, jack, jack, give me game there. No, no, no. Card number two, blue dark comes out. Yeah, number two, three, five, ten. There they go, number five, four, a wreck, a wreck. And Teddy's bending up the fence, down the fence. If he doesn't be careful, he's going to hit that fence. Ladies and gentlemen, there's been a slight accident on 32 cars. I have two ball with the prime of my phone. Go down that man to see he's all right. Take it away, but be careful. I'm down in the track now. As I go over, two went by there, and I cry up, three went by there, and I'm a little across the track. Here you are, mister. Say something proud so they know you're all right. You heard from that driver. He's okay. Take it away back in front of me. This is way back around the press box. For those who tuned in late, 13 just said, we're going to 13. They're going to 5, 4, 30. Went by twice. That little midget, look at the midget go. Then there goes a little midget. Yeah, 38. How'd that get right? Oh, they're going to go 5, 4, 5. And we're going to have a head winner. We're going to have a head winner.
And the winner is... Beetle Bomb.
Welcome to the making of Altoona America. During this program, you'll experience parts of one of Altoona's greatest celebrations of our musical heritage. One of the area's finest examples of musical talent and inspiration, Paul Winter, will host this event. Altoona America is not only a tribute to Altoona, but to one of its greatest musical teachers, the legendary John Monti, former Altoona School District band leader and director of music. First, here's one of Altoona America's chief organizers, Mr. Neil Port, with some background on the event.
Altoona America is a dream of Paul Winter's, which I believe he has had in him for years. And when Paul threw a party for his mom back in November of last year, and he got together his old bands, his Silver Liners dance band, his German band, and he did some improvising with his old bandmaster and teacher and my bandmaster, John Monti. The evening was such a fun evening, and it was so nostalgic that I think it became something that went to the front burner for Paul.
The casino at Lakemont was the site chosen for the Altoona America concert. Parked outside was a mobile recording studio trucked in from Philadelphia. They would record the final performance in multi-track stereo for later release to the general public on cassette. Inside the casino, there was a lot of work to be done in rehearsing for the show. The performance was just 2 days away, but first, a certain amount of catching up was in order, and there were plenty of John Monti stories to be told.
When I was a sophomore in high school, I had taken trumpet lessons for about 3 years and hadn't played in a band in junior high. So, and a lot of my friends were in a band in high school, and I went in to see John, and I said, I'd like to be in a band. And he said, well, that's fine. Bring your trumpet in, and we'll see what we can do. So when I went into the test to do the tryout, he hummed a few notes and said to play the trumpet. And I couldn't match the notes. I had no ear for music whatsoever. He said, son, go home and get yourself a clarinet. And all you have to do is play the clarinet with the keys. You don't have to have an ear for music. So from that, I played clarinet and tenor sax and ended up in a band in my college band after that.
The Altoona America Band was made up of the Paul Winter Consort as its core group, members of Paul's old group, the Silver Liners, and other Altoona alumni. Although the group hadn't played together before as a whole, it didn't take long for everything to start gelling together.
Darwin has the...
Here's the first part.
First clarinet?
Here's the second and third.
Well, were you going to play that?
No, you go ahead and play it on that, and I'll play the second part.
Here's the second and third.
I don't mind if I play first, second, and third. Whatever. We can double it.
Any oboe parts on that, Dick?
Oh, wow, look at this.
Great group.
Okay? I'd like everybody to meet our illustrious pianist who's just stayed up all night copying out some of the new pieces for this, Paul Halley. Oh. Hey, Jack, give it a ring. Let's see what this pitch is of the bell. Beautiful. Is that F sharp? Could you push in a little bit, Jack? Thank you. dinner's tomorrow, we can get into the dynamics a little bit. You can coach us on that, because I know there's beautiful swells in that first section that happened. But I think it's going to work instrumentally.
Finally, the time came for the band to meet John Monti.
Where are you from?
I'm from New York. I'm Long Island.
What's your name?
Mark Perchinon. Perchinon.
Oh, you're not Italian?
No. How about Perchinini? I'll change it.
It's coming close. Oh, well,
Paul Halley.
Paul.
Hi.
Elliot Wadobian.
Hey, Paul. It's nice to meet you.
Paul and John. I know a guy put those two together and he wound up with a big piece of property in Rome.
Is that right?
At 82 years of age, John Monti certainly hadn't lost his quick wit and sharp sense of humor. The next question on everyone's mind was, would he be able to conduct music from 30 years ago without using sheet music that his eyes could no longer focus on?
It's enough sharp up there!
Needless to say, the music still lives in John Monti. The following day, the next order of business was to whip the John Monti Day alumni band into shape. They came from all over to honor their former band leader. Mr. Monti showed off some of the methods that he perfected over the years to get the most out of his people. John has a formula for effective leadership and motivation that we can all learn from. First, he raises the level of expectation and demands excellence from his players. Then he gives lots of praise and adds humor to keep things light. Most of all, Mr. Monti enjoys conducting and getting the best out of everyone.
The rhythm is gone. Chum, 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 chum. And you go, ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da a little bit slower, a little more to the beat. Right on the beat. Conducted a better band in my life, and I mean it. This band must record this concert. It has to be played on our radio stations, TV stations. You are terrific. It just seems like the cream came home. Every man played his part. I didn't find a bad note. Didn't find a bad note anywhere. That's why they call me Father John. I let you confess yourselves.
He was a teacher. He expected maybe not perfection, but he expected close to perfection. He made you feel good about yourself. He wanted to win. When we marched in a parade and competition in Washington, we wanted to come in number one, number two. was okay, but it wasn't what we were going for. So he taught us to be winners.
Mr. Monti was my champion. He's my surrogate father. And his influence on my entire life, it still affects me.
The Altoona America concert was scheduled to take place the next day. And for these former members of Paul Winter's original Little German Band, it would be a very special reunion.
Paul and I first met in seventh grade, junior high school. We started playing in the band together there. And I was in the original Silver Liners band and German band. And so we've known each other, I guess, since seventh grade. And I haven't seen Paul for 35 years. I guess what stood out was even back in seventh grade, Paul had all the markings of going on to greater things. He was a great organizer and a perfectionist and wanted everything done as well as possible.
Paul had a dance band. It was sort of a big band or a small band dance band. And we used to play at the Altoona YMCA co-ed night. And co-ed night was just sort of like a school dance. And we would play for the dance. And the interesting thing about it is that all our girlfriends would come to the dance. And of course, every once in a while we would dance with the girls, but on occasion there would be some guys that would want to dance with our girlfriends. So what we would do is we'd speed up the music so they couldn't dance with them.
Mrs. Winter would drive us to all kinds of places. And I can remember one incident. We were down in Huntington in a prison, and we played for these prisoners. And here we were, junior high school kids, and they were marching these prisoners in row by row, and we were their main entertainment. And we weren't sure whether they were going to kill us or whether they listened, but they listened and they seemed to enjoy it. And we were their main attraction, and they had a movie which followed us.
One night we actually got paid. We got $2 among the five of us. We got 40 cents each, which we thought was terrific. That was big money for 12-year-olds. And so that was our first experience kind of on the road in greater Altoona. The next year, it must have been, in our seventh grade year at Roosevelt Junior High School, we formed the Silver Liners, which was a nine-piece group, a dance band, and it was so named because we had chosen Look for the Silver Lining as our theme song. And we made our debut, might have been maybe our eighth grade year, we made our debut in a stage concert, an assembly during the school day at Roosevelt. And my mom had taken us all down to Mo Schulman's men's shop and gotten us matching brown corduroy jackets. And so we looked pretty spiffy and did our show, which included a rendition of Glow Little Glowworm, in which we stood up and sang the chorus together.
That was just the beginning, but he was just a youngster in junior high school when I got him, and I know that he prepared his lessons well, and even when he wasn't sure of something, his mother would remind him that the fingering was such and such, and the timing was such and such, because there were times the lessons extended beyond the hour, maybe beyond an hour and a half or so, and he'd be looking across the street there into that forest that we had in that vacant lot there. Perhaps there'd be a few youngsters playing ball in there, and I knew that he was awfully tired, but I was tough on students. When they had it, I gave them all I had, all they could take, and even more. But that's the story of Paul Winter, and he proved that he was great, and he's going to go further than that yet.
He somehow, I think intuitively, brings things on to the highest level of values. So everyone wants to live up to that. He ennobles us. And I think many people who maybe would never have done much with music or maybe never had tapped their own spirit toward finding their path in life, whether it be music or any other kind of work, might not have found that, at least at the time they did in their lives, if it weren't for John and their experience with him.
Finally, the big day had arrived. All of the preparation was done, and the payoff was about to take place. It would be a day to remember when looking back on the history of music in Altoona. John Monti was in his glory on this, one of the most proudest occasions of his life. Technicians were standing by to record every note, and the people waited with great anticipation.
Let the record show that on a glorious Sunday, August 2nd, 1992, here in the heartland of America, at Lakemont Park Pavilion, playground for Altoona, Pennsylvanians, a few friends and former students of John Monti, music educator with a capital E, gathered to pay tribute not only to Maestro John Monti, but to music, his master, as well as to the greater Altoona area, a cradle of music education. The idea for this happening was born over 15 years ago in the fertile mind of Paul Winter. It's only fitting that the event occur on the occasion of the 35th high school reunion of the 1957 Altoona High School class. That's Paul's class. How many, incidentally, here are from that class, 1957? There they are. You all look wonderful. You haven't changed a bit, and all the other malarkey you've been telling each other for the past couple days. I understand you had a function last evening at the Ramada. It couldn't have been too important. Bob Jubilier wasn't there. And we present to you the Silver Liners.
Two, one, two, three, four.
About 20 years ago, the Boston Common came together as a barbershop quartet in the Boston area with two Altoona natives, Terry Clark and Larry Tully. And they have, in the intervening two decades, toured numerous countries in the world, 48 of the 50 states, and were the winners in 1980 of the International Competition of the Society for the Encouragement and Improvement, or whatever, of Barbershop Quartets. And next to the Buffalo Bills have been the most popular barbershop quartet in America. Now that the Buffalo Bills have gone the way of the home on the range and the Buffaloes themselves, I would say the Boston Common is America's number one barbershop quartet. We're thrilled they're with us today. Please welcome them, the Boston Common.
Oh, how many we got here? Thank you.
Seems like old times having you to walk with. Seems like old times having you to talk with. And it's still a thrill just to have my arms around you. Still that it was the day I found you. Seems like old times. Dinner dates and flowers. Seems like old times. Staying up for hours, making dreams come true, doing things we used to do. Seems like old times, being with you in my arms. Seems like old times, being with you.
There's a place I'd like to be, and it's not in Tennessee, where your friendly neighbors smile and say hello. It's a pleasure and a treat to meander down the street. That's why I want the whole wide world to know, to love those dear hearts and gentle people who live in my hometown. And gentle people will never ever let you down. They read a good book from Friday till Monday. That's how the weekend goes. I've got a dream house I'll build there one day, with a picket fence and rambling rose. I feel so welcome each time that I return. Like a cloud, dear hearts and gentle people who live in love and might be it ever so humble, with friends who live in my hometown.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. That barbershop quartets are not unique, certainly, to Altoona, but what was unique to Altoona was the fact that we were on the Keith circuit, as well as, I think, on another circuit, John, a couple of the old Keith circuits. That meant in vaudeville days, they would put shows together in New York, and they'd send them around to all the theaters that each of the towns had. And Altoona was a very special town. We were on the main line, and it caused people like George Burns to write about us, because I think in some cases we were the last thing on the line before we got back to New York. And it was always fun to talk about Altoona because it meant...
Pardon me, the stranger, but my name is Brown. I overheard you saying you were leaving town. I've done lots of traveling, and if I may boast, everybody's heard of me from coast to coast. Mention my name in Sheboygan, it's the greatest little town in the world. Just tell them all you're an old friend of mine, and every door in town will have a big welcome sign. So mention my name in Sheboygan, and if you ever get in a jam, just mention my name. I said mention my name, but please don't tell them where I am. Mention my name in Paducah, it's the greatest little town in the world. I know a gal there you'll simply adore. She was Miss Paducah back in 1904. So mention my name in Paducah, and if you ever get in a mess, just mention my name. I said mention my name, but please don't give them my address. Mention my name in Altoona, it's the greatest little town in the world. I know the big shots in their city hall, they've even got my picture on the post office wall. So mention my name in Altoona, and if you ever get in a spat, just mention my name. I said mention my name, but please don't tell them where I am.
Wrong, but did you go to Annapolis, to that Navy school at Annapolis?
Yeah, I did, Neil. How'd you know that?
I sensed it from your dapper dress, from your bearing, from your very quick wit, and from your athletic ability.
Gee. Neil, didn't you go to Penn State?
Yeah, I went to Penn State. How did you know that?
I saw the ring on your finger when you were picking your nose.
Finger.
If someone asked me what Altoona is to me, I would say that Altoona is spirit. It's a land of spirit with music in its heart. And whenever I hear music that touches my soul, I am reconnected to my roots in Altoona, into all of the music that I heard here, to my parents and my family, my teachers at Baker School and Roosevelt and high school, you know, all the different kinds of bands that I had the privilege to play with, to the symphony, to the choruses that we heard. And at the heart of all of that is one grand gentleman who cares very deeply about music, about people, about community, and about Altoona. He's someone who has inspired enthusiasm, hope, adventure, and much more in the lives of many of us. And it's a great privilege to have him with us today and to have him play music with us. Please welcome our friend, our mentor, our soul brother, John Monti.
Well, it just reactivated my whole mental system. Every time I would sit down, the thought came to me, well, I wonder what we're going to do about this. And the next thing you know, I'm remembering the first day I ever taught, the first time I ever played an instrument. Every place I've been that I've forgotten about, every summer I was either touring the country or playing at the shore or touring in Europe or something, and it all had to do with music. And I kept thinking, well, how much of this should I talk about? It's all personal. But it seemed like it was already worked out with Paul, as he had planned this dream of his, which incidentally came to be. Personally, I think it's his most wonderful thing. But as far as I'm concerned, it not only made my day, but it made my life. I reviewed my life, and I began looking around for things to remember about and came up with so many tangible things like pictures and sounds that brought it all together. But when I heard that alumni band playing, the quality of the sound and the musicianship of these people who have been playing for 10, 20, 30, 40 years, playing along with others who are professionals even today, I just couldn't help but think, well, if I had a band like this, all I'd have to do is put a uniform on them and they would be professional, because they were playing the most difficult, the most interesting, and the most classic of literature in that short concert. And then what talent was there? The youngsters of the later years were exposed to Brubaker, the arranger for the Navy Band, with his arrangement, the terrific arrangement, the Mancini number, and then to play under him, and to think that here's the kid we started in a grade school who didn't even know what a French horn was, and finally went to Juilliard and finally became a master of his instrument. Not only that, but then in arranging and composing and everything else, I thought, well, I just didn't live in vain, did I? I had something to do with it. I didn't achieve what they achieved, but I went along for the ride. I'm a product of Altoona. I wasn't born in this country. I was born in the old country. Came here when I was 3 years old, but I didn't bring anything with me except my father, who was a conservatory, and all I had to do was listen to him and watch him teaching other people. That was his business. And go to the theater where he played in the pits for silent movies and vaudeville shows, et cetera, et cetera. And then to go to his band rehearsals. He started his own band, the Italian Christopher Columbus Band. That's what he was brought here for. That was easy for me to do, and I didn't want to do it, and I didn't care about it. But once I got to college and did my first student teaching at Keith Junior High School, I knew that I was made of the things that are human. I didn't want material things. I just wanted to be with people, and I just loved playing with those youngsters up there, teaching them for the first time, and felt that I had accomplished something. But these people, if you don't nurture them, they're just going to pull down what you do. Well, we have to bring them up to your level. And that's the attitude I've had as an educator. I love the teachers who took an interest in me and brought me up, and as somebody said, chipped away the bad stuff, which is, I thought that was a great example. And it works. And when the kids say, well, you taught me a lot, we taught each other. We come up together. I just say, you raised me. I didn't raise you. You raised me. Without you, I'd be nothing. And once you get the confidence of a youngster like that, he forgets about being arrogant and defying you. So first you build attitudes. You build trust. And it works.
You sense with John that he's got a very loving soul that's tolerant of all sorts of people and different kinds of behavior. And yet underneath it, he is profoundly dedicated. Tough in the best sense of the word, in that he is committed to his work and committed to see that we do well. And for our own sake, not for his sake. And so that combination of qualities, I think, made him one of the most renowned teachers that has ever taught in the Altoona schools, and I think perhaps one of the most beloved figures that has ever come out of Altoona.
While Mr. Monti encouraged individual forms of expression, he also demanded excellence and precision from his bands. Their showings in the cherry blossom parades in Washington, D.C. confirmed that Altoona High School had one of the best marching bands in the country.
When we used to go every third year. So we went back in 63 and we walloped them all and won it. And again in three more years, 66, we did it again. And then Darwin took them down in 69 and did it again. But it was an all-boys marching band at that time with a beautiful front of maidens called the majorette corps, and we had changed from the male color guard to the female color guard. So we had a beautiful retinue of young musicians and marching and maneuvering personnel that caught the eye of the judges and caught the hearts of the people.
And now, coming up in the background, the Altoona Senior High School Band from Altoona, VA. Let's give them a look and a listen.
You'll never beat Barnum and Bailey, so we took on that motif of being a circus band, and we took it up to a nice, bright step.
Those are our guys and gals right now, the Altoona Senior High School Band out there. They're marching in front of the judges' stand right now. And if you don't think you can't help but feel proud right now, believe me, you certainly bust with pride. They look as good as $1 million. They said they came to win, and they will. Listen to them now. Once again, ladies and gentlemen, and this time where we hoped we would be, and Mr. Monti and the band has brought us here to the winner's circle. Mr. Monti, on behalf of everybody, congratulations on a marvelous achievement. We're
thanks
so
for
proud
covering
of
it. I think the people from Altoona have never seen anything like this. I think it's bigger than the Rose Bowl parade. The competition's terrific, and everybody's really sharp for this occasion, and you have to congratulate those youngsters and their parents and everybody that supported this thing, especially the city of Altoona. It's the greatest city in the United States.
Well, you have no idea how proud we are of you and of this trophy. Again, first place band over 75. Let's turn it around a little bit so they can get a look at the emblem on the insignia on it too.
From the other three we have, this is a fourth one, the fifth one we won. Two firsts, a second, a third, and a fourth.
I just heard you being congratulated by a man who placed second to you after losing to you again in 63.
Yes, yes, he was delighted to lose to us. He said we were better than before, so if that's a sign of it, I've just about reached the peak, don't you think, Dick?
Well, Mr. Monti, you, I felt that you were, not saying it, but you were confident that you had the capability of winning. I always felt that from just talking to you and from things that you had said, and they proved themselves today but well.
Well, I hope so. I've judged so many bands, I know what to look for, I know how to evaluate them. But I had 2 hours to watch these bands organizing this morning and getting into position, and I'll tell you, I was pretty scared, especially that Humboldt band just went by. I'm glad that they're under the 75 category because they would have given us a lot of trouble. I didn't know at the time, I thought we'd come in second when I saw them in the winner's circle, and I believe all the youngsters were quite surprised when they heard we came in first and had it sewed up, because you know you wait there about an hour before the parade's over.
Well, Mr. Monti, again, congratulations. We are so proud of you and every member of the band, and good luck again next time. My goodness, it's been wonderful.
Well, thank you. Thank you and all the people of Altoona that helped to support this thing.
Our pleasure. John Monti, ladies and gentlemen.
Winning the Cherry Blossom Parade for the second time in 1966 gave the Altoona High School Band national recognition and respect. But Mr. Monti remembers the very first trip to Washington with the band in 1954, when their participation was a little less than welcome.
We come marching up, and one of the Chamber of Commerce committeemen who had a list of the bands and was placing the bands into their orders, into their marching situation, says, well, where's this band from? And I says, from Altoona, Pennsylvania. And he looked and he says, you're not on here. He says, where's your invitation? I says, we don't have an invitation. You're supposed to have an invitation? He says, well, you certainly have to have an invitation. You can't be in this parade without an invitation. I said, well, I wasn't told that. I was just told to come down to be in the parade. So he said, well, you can't be in this parade. I said, hey, man, I said, we've been up all night driving down here, and we still have a long way to go. I says, we're either going to be in this parade, and there was a bunch of little black boys marching up and down one of the side streets there, having fun. They had their own little parade. I said, or else I'm going to get those kids, and we're going to have our own parade. He says, oh, you wouldn't dare. I said, try me. And he said, well, okay, you get in here. Well, to make a long story short, we didn't know at the time that the parade had been established, and that we were sort of infringing on an area where we didn't belong. But anyhow, since we were allowed to march, we asked to be judged, and we came in third. We won third place. From then on, we were invited every year.
Mr. Monti is well known for introducing majorettes into the Altoona High School marching band format. As a pioneer in the use of twirlers in his shows, he paved the way for other schools like Johnstown to follow suit.
We started with nine girls as the first majorette crew in the history of majorettes. It was an all-boys band, and we wanted to put the beauty up in front of the beasts, so to speak, as I used to kid the kids. But Jenny Blatchford and a girl named Gloria Hyder from Bellwood were the only two that knew how to spin a baton. What you see there now is the second corps later on. And they trained the other girls so that we had a precision corps. And I made up the routine. I asked them for several stances and several twirls, and we put it to eight bar phrases and repeated them, and finally we had something that looked like it was a maneuver or a routine, a spinning routine, and that was the very beginning. And now Jenny did not make head majorette. Jeanette Sturgis was a taller girl, much taller, and she was voted as head majorette. Now, this is the second corps. We were able to get 18 girls, and eventually we were up to 36. This is Carol Dandria, who was the leader of the majorettes back between the years of 52 to 55. And when she graduated, I was able to get her first professional dancing achievement by playing state fairs in the Midwest. And from there, she went to the Copacabana in New York and then toured the world. Today, she's quite a professional dancer and has her own dancing school out in Hollywood. And now this is Carol McGurk, who continued as a teacher of baton twirling for Jenny Blatchford School of Baton Twirling, and then started her own school, which she still continues to have in Altoona. She has produced many national champions, as have Jenny Blatchford, who has 15 schools out in California. Tom Petro has spent many, many years with the National Guard Band. That's the fellow to the left, and he owns the Richie Music Store. The fellow in the center is a Bill Cover, a drummer that I enticed to go down to the Navy School of Music, where he learned to be an instructor, then took over a band in Vietnam, and later on one in Germany. He's a retired warrant officer, bandmaster, one of our finest drum majors, one of our finest drummers. And also we have a young lady there. You say, well, you didn't have any girls in the band. We did have the girls in the concert band. And this is Fawn Cox, who played a marimba solo and played percussion instruments in the Altoona Senior High School concert band. You were permitted to play in the concert band and to wear the uniform.
Five of the top highlights of Mr. Monty's career are the five prizes won in the national band competition at the Cherry Blossom Parades in Washington, D.C. The band is forming on the field a replica trophy representing the two first places won by the Altoona High School bands of 1963 and 66. The march, of course, will be the winner, Barnum and Bailey favorites. The majorettes formed the year 63 and later the year 66.
After reviewing the life and career of John Monti, we can all gain inspiration from his love of music and people. There was yet another proud moment to come for John Monti during the Altoona America Day celebration. It was the John Monti Band Concert, held outdoors at Lakemont Park on August 2, 1992. Let's watch now some of the scenes from the third video in our series entitled The John Monti Day Alumni Band.
All-time favorites, Barman Bailey's favorites, is another one of our all-time favorites. The gentleman we honor today, the man who has created Altoona's greatest legacy in music, ladies and gentlemen, Mr. John Monti.
As you can see, the alumni that came back to honor John Monti truly appreciate and respect his contribution to